Thank you for tuning in today to Coming Home. My name is Charles Daugherty, and I want to talk.
My faith journey coming to Christ was in 1984, and the early part of that was just challenge.
In this world, you will have trouble. But then he goes on to say, don't be afraid or fear not, because I've overcome the world. I've beaten the things you're facing.
Welcome to Coming Home, KFXB's program that's here weekly on Thursdays and Sundays. We're glad you're here. I'm Charles Daugherty. I'm your host today, and I have the privilege of having two wonderful guests with us, friends, and Mike here and John there. And Mike and I come to realize as we prepared to come here for this program that we'd known each other back in 2003. And so we have an awesome program for you today. We're not going to be able to get everything done in 1 hour. So I've asked these two about coming back next week, and they're going to come back. So when you watch this, tell your friends and get them to watch next week as well. This is called Coming Home. And I want to share with you two scriptures before we get into talking to these two. Because I know some of you, you know, you've been hurt by the church. You're sitting at home and your church for you is the TV. Some of you are pastors and leaders in congregations. And so today is really going to be extremely important about coming home to our real home and our real purpose and who we're serving. In Ephesians, the book of Ephesians, chapter 1 and verse 20, Paul's been praying, 18 and 19 and 20, that the eyes of our heart would be opened and enlightened so that we would know really who we are and how great God is. And in 20 he says, which he brought about in Christ when he, God, raised him, Jesus, from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places. And we go ahead to chapter 2 and verse 6. It talks about what Christ has done, being rich in mercy, leading up to verse 6 of chapter 2. Saying, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places. This morning, we were waking up to the radio alarm, and the song was, this is not my home. This is not where I belong. And we know that we read about that we're strangers and aliens here, that our citizenship is in heaven. We have dual citizenship. And so today, as we're talking about serving in our cities, serving people, no matter who they are, but being the servants to others the way Jesus was a servant to others, we're really talking about representing our home the right way. We're ambassadors of the kingdom of God. And we don't want to just simply long to be gone from here. We want to use the time that God has given us so that we represent home the right way. So today, that's really what our topic's about. So we have John Kieffer, who is the state facilitator with the Mission America Coalition, along with various other responsibilities, a pastor serving in Appleton for many years, and then the Lord transitioned him into serving other pastors. And we have Mike Breininger.
There you go.
All right. Forgot to look at my phonetic spelling here. I told these two, we're not going to be stuffy and formal. We're going to be talking to each other. So, who is a pastor in Richland Center, serving the citizens and the community and the school community and the homeless and so forth in Richland Center, and still in a congregation, but serving other pastors in a great way. So, we're going to talk about these two, but I'm going to give them about 2 minutes to share their elevator speech, their story of maybe three, you know, whatever. Go with the flow. John, how did you get here today from where you used to be separated from God?
When I was 13 years old, 1972, I came from a very dysfunctional family. Both my parents were alcoholics, workaholics. My dad was a rageaholic. There was a lot of abuse and neglect and chaos. And out of that confusion, of course, I was looking for love and respect in all of the wrong places. And that got me in with the wrong crowd. And I was engaged in a lot of really bad behavior. And that got me into some terrible trouble with my parents. I got grounded for a month, which felt like cruel and unusual punishment to me. And in the midst of that, I wanted to get back in their good graces so I could get my freedom back. And I remember some of the neighborhood boys came over and said, hey, let's go to the Dairy Queen. And I got permission to go, but my mom said, you come straight home. Forgot about going straight home. Ran into a girl from church, and she was witnessing to us. I got back home, and of course, my mom was out looking for me. When she came home, she was enraged. Where were you? And I said, this girl stopped us and was witnessing to us. And she said, do you know what that means? And I said, I really don't know what that means. And my mom proceeded to share the gospel, the good news that Jesus died for me. Now, being brought up in a parochial school, I had heard that Jesus had died for the sin of the world, but I never understood that he died for me personally.
That's good.
And that came to light to me. And she said, do you understand this? And I said, yeah, I do. For the first time in my life, I understood that Jesus died for me, for my sin. And then she said, do you believe it? And I said, yes. And she said, now you're a Christian. And that was really the transition in my life where Christ became real to me and his word came alive to me and really began to transform my life.
Awesome. And Lard's taking you through, how did you become a pastor?
Well, I remember in the ninth grade, we had a project where we were to interview someone in the community of a job we might be interested in. And I thought, well, I'll interview the local pastor. I thought that looks like an interesting job, you know, preaching and teaching the word of God. And I interviewed a pastor, and he talked about the important role he had for the community. And that was news to me. And so at that early age, even in ninth grade, I started to sense a sense of calling. And I worked for Kimberly-Clark for 10 years when I got out of high school. And the opportunity opened itself up for me to come on as an associate pastor within my local church. And our church was growing quickly at that time. And I went on staff in 1990 with the local congregation. And I served that church for 21 years.
My goodness. Folks, as so often we find on this program, we find different individuals that have made a significant impact on us. And we can't minimize the fact that every one of you are impacting someone else. And so it's important that we really learn what it means to be at home with Christ, seated in heaven, to bring heaven to earth as we often pray. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. So that is amazing. So all of the things that we have, that I know you're involved in, we're going to hear about, that pastor had a big impact on your life. Yeah. Wonderful. Mike, how about you? Tell us your story.
All right. So my parents moved with my older siblings from Long Island, New York in 1950. My father had been raised in the city, New York City, had worked on the Empire State Building, Wall Street, and he decided he wanted to be a farmer. Never been on a farm in his life, didn't know anything about it. So he packed up the whole family and said, we're moving to Wisconsin and we're going to be farmers. We came out to Wisconsin and, we started out as chicken farmers. That didn't work out so well. And then we became dairy farmers, did much better at that. My father was a Roman Catholic. My mother converted to Roman Catholicism. We were a nominal home in terms of going to church occasionally, but it was never a serious matter in our home. In fact, I had an uncle who was a Christian pastor, and my father used to call him a holy roller, and he didn't especially like that seriousness about the Bible. So I didn't really care for religious things, for going to church. When I was old enough, late in high school, I stopped going. When I got into college, I had nothing to do with church, with God, walked in the other direction. I was an athlete. I wrestled for the University of Wisconsin in Madison. And so I put most of my energy in that. And I knew that I was going to be a successful businessman when I graduated. So that was my focus afterwards. 2 weeks left of my college life and my undergraduate anyway, and I met this girl. And we hit it off right away, and she was from Connecticut, I was from Wisconsin. She was graduating in 2 weeks, I was graduating in 2 weeks, she was going back to Connecticut, I was staying in Wisconsin. I said, well, you know, we've kind of made a real romantic connection here. Would you think about staying in Wisconsin? And she said, no. I said, well, whoa, why not? She said, well, here's the problem. I am a Christian and you are not.
Wow.
I said, well, what does it mean? What does that mean? I don't know exactly what you're talking about. I said, I did go to church when I was younger. She said, well, that's not what it means to be a Christian. You have to repent of your sins and ask Jesus to come into your heart. I said, well, so if I do that, then you're going to stay here in Wisconsin? She said, yes, I would do that. And so I said, well, let's take care of it right now. So, you know, I said a prayer, and I really didn't know what I was doing at the time, but she called up her mother and said, I've met this fine Christian young man out in Wisconsin, and so I'm going to stay here for a while, which was stretching the truth a little bit. But her mother said, oh, that's wonderful. I'm going to send him a special Bible. So she sent me a Bible. And I started reading the Bible, and I was immediately captured. Hmm. So I don't believe I became a Christian when I said the prayer, because I didn't even know what I was doing. But I tell you, shortly after I started reading the scripture, I knew it was the truth. Mm-hmm. I knew it was the Lord. And I said yes to him in my heart, and I couldn't put it down. I poured over it day after day. I didn't really have anybody to teach me or understand, so I read and read and studied that. In fact, one time I remember I was talking to a man, and I said, you know, I was reading in the book of Job the other day. And he started laughing at me. I said, well, what's so funny? He said, it's called Job, not Job.
Well, you're going to be a successful businessman, remember?
That's right. So that's how it all started, is meeting this girl. And I went into the business world after I graduated from the university with an undergraduate degree. Very successful in that, but the Lord kept pulling at me, and I spent a lot more time reading the scripture, and eventually got involved in a few churches, some good experiences and some not so good experiences. There was a church that we were in. It was growing, and people were coming to the Lord every week. Had lots of young people my age at that time. I was in my early mid-20s, and hundreds of people coming to Christ. And the older people that were there weren't appreciative of that. They didn't want the young people coming in and taking over, so they wanted to fire the pastor. And it just ended up a big conflict, and the church, he left, the pastor left, and the church exploded. So I decided to start a church. I was still a businessman.
Is that right?
I decided to start a church. So without a pastor, without a building, without even knowing what I was doing, I started a church in 1984. And that's the church that I'm pastoring now, but I was not the pastor then. So that's kind of how things started in the church life.
Is your wife's mother still with us, or is she
passed away? She's passed away, but she was around long enough to see me follow the Lord, be serious about it. Of course, my wife and I, The girl became my wife. We got married. We've been married for 37 years now.
So you passed that test.
I hope I'm right. My wife will let me know if I'm not.
You passed that test, but it only seems like 10, right?
Just five.
Five, okay. So here we have, listen. I'm so excited because, John, it was a young girl and your mother. And here it's a young girl and her mother. I hope you're listening out there, ladies. Your wife now wife, mm-hmm. said no because you're not a Christian. We'd not compromise. That is stretched the truth a little bit, but did not compromise.
She was very firm on that, and I respected her for that.
See, that's key.
Yeah, even though I wasn't a Christian, I thought, wow, this must really mean something. And that's what drew me to wanting the Lord.
I want to repeat that. This must mean something. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're 15 minutes into our program here, and this is gold, folks. I hope you're hearing this. So Mike, we're going to focus on you. We're going to focus on Richland Center, Wisconsin. You are a real family man. So before we even get to the pastor part, the city part, You had 16 children, nine of which, I'm looking at my notes. Folks, it's okay to have notes. I'm looking at my notes. Nine adopted, 16 children. What? You fostered 40 children, mm-hmm. and you've had 16 young men live with you and mentored them. That's a big household. So tell it, what led you into fostering, adopting, mentoring these young men? Is there any link back to your to that first congregation where the young people were coming to Christ?
So let me start out with the children part of it first. I was reading, as I mentioned, I was reading the scripture, just pouring over it. And, you know, the first thing that God told Adam and Eve was to multiply and fill the earth, you know, to have children. And I kept reading that theme through the scripture, you know, raise your children in the ways of God. They were a treasure. They were valuable. And my wife and I had two children, two daughters. And she was ready to say, you know, that's good enough. Sure. And I kept saying, but that's not right. The Bible says we're supposed to have, you know, fill the earth, you know, have children and fill the earth.
The Bible her mother gave you.
Right? Her mother gave me. So we had a lengthy biblical discourse over this for about 4 years before we started having more children. And she was completely on board. She was like, it is true. God really does want us to have more children. So we started having children again. And when we reached 7 biological children, we ran out of biological time. Mm-hmm. My wife couldn't have children anymore. And it may seem hard for people to believe, but we were brokenhearted. We wanted more children. We thought we were not half full yet with 7 children. We loved the children. We loved raising them. We loved having them. And they were just as, they're strong-willed and can be just as irritating as anybody else's children out there, but they were a treasure from the Lord. And so we started with, after our last one was born, maybe a couple years old, started feeling like, well, if we can't have any more biologically, we'll start taking children into our home. That's when we started into foster care. So we took in foster kids, which is in some ways a really heartbreaking experience because you have those children. We had a lot of young children. We'd had them for 2 or 3 years. Usually their parents were, you know, drug addicts or alcoholics. They were in jail or prison. After we had the children for 2 or 3 years, they were completely integrated into our family, completely attached to us. Parents would get out of jail, and the kids would go back to the parents. After a number of years of this happening, we said, well, maybe we ought to think about something more permanent. This is really good that we can do this, but something more permanent. And we decided to start adopting children. We wanted to adopt internationally, but because we already had so many children of our own and the income requirement was so high, the only way we could adopt children was through the special needs program in the state of Wisconsin because they basically paid all the costs of it. And so we started fostering and then adopting special needs kids. And I thought we were going to have 12. That was the number that I had in my mind. I don't know, apparently that wasn't the number that God had in his mind, but as we adopted sibling groups, and finally we adopted a total of 9 special needs kids, which is what we have now. My last ones are triplets that are 12 years old, so I'm going to be well into my 60s by the time they graduate from high school, but I'm thrilled with that. So it's part of a biblical mandate that I saw for us, but it was also something God put in our hearts. I would not expect everybody to think that they're supposed to have 16 children or adopt all these kids, although we should be asking the Lord about that because that's a real issue, a need. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I think, you know, everybody ought to be thinking about the importance.
We are to raise up our children to enlarge and strengthen the culture of trusting God, walking with God, listening with God, obeying God, honoring God.
And so in our house every morning, still, on my 7 oldest children are out of the house on their own now, but I still have 9 biological children, and I have 4 international kids that live with me, one from Korea, one from China, Taiwan, or Thailand, and Panama. 2 of them are Christian and 2 are not. But every morning we have devotions before everybody goes off to school. We read out of the scripture, we discuss it, and then everybody prays. If they're not a Christian, they don't have to pray. So two of them don't pray. But they're there the whole year with us. We've been doing this for a number of years, and of course my kids are always, you know, telling other people about what God says in the Bible. Usually our international kids come as non-Christians and leave as Christians. Mm-hmm. So that has been a significant way for us to reach the world. We've had kids from all over the world in our home that have come to Christ.
This is amazing. So then we're going to get to this city reaching part. We are. We've got about 7 minutes. We need to kind of transition over there. But really, you're reaching a city. You're getting a small city started right here in your home. So and fostering these kids and these international students. You know, you're going to have sister cities in other countries. You've got 42 short-term international mission trips.
Yes.
And that's more than one a year since you've been in ministry. So how did that start? I mean, and you've been involved with Youth with a Mission. And
so I have always had, again, going back to reading the scripture, I've always believed, you know, we're supposed to go out and preach the good news and tell the people about it. We do that in our own community, in our own state, and in our region as much as we can. I never felt like that was enough, and of course the Bible talks about going to the ends of the world with it. So I said, well, we better go and do that. So I think the first mission trip I took, I think, was to Guatemala.
Okay.
And we actually partnered with another church because I didn't really know what to do. I just said, anybody in church wants to go on this, let's go and do a mission trip in Guatemala. So we did that, and I was kind of couldn't stop after that. People were so open to the gospel in the places that we went. We did a lot of work in Latin America. I've been over in India, and it just seemed like in the U.S. there's kind of, you know, they don't want to hear it. It closed the door in our face, or, you know, please don't talk to me. I got my own beliefs. But when we went to the other countries, whether it was out of politeness or a true hunger for the Lord, there was always such an openness. And we saw God move in tremendous ways. So I just couldn't help but taking more and more groups to various countries. We did get connected in with Youth with a Mission. In fact, we sent a family from our church out to be base directors at Youth with a Mission in Panama. They started a new mission work there. So we've gone there 20 some times. And we've got another family that are assistant base directors in Richmond, Virginia, and over in France. And we've got orphan homes in India. In any case, there's invitations started coming in more than we could even go and meet them. And I just had to pray and ask the Lord, where do you want us to go? But we've never had a shortage of people wanting to go out on the short-term mission trips. We usually focus primarily on evangelism, but sometimes we also do medical outreaches, we do children's ministries, we go to the dumps. I don't take people to five-star hotels when we do mission trips.
Right.
We go out in the jungle.
Now you just said something that probably went by, and you weigh in here anytime you want, John. So, but you said we go to the dumps. Now, I think I'm pretty sure I know what you mean, but tell our listeners.
So, in that case, we literally go to the dumps.
Yes.
City dumps, where
yes.
There are people that live by going into the garbage, pulling things out, eating it, wearing it, building shelters out of it. That's how they live.
Correct.
It's hard, maybe hard for people to believe that here in the U.S. I don't think we have that here, but in other countries, that happens almost every city dump I've ever been at. There are people that live at the dumps. So we go there and talk to them about the Lord. But we also go into remote places where they've never heard the gospel before. Mm-hmm. I've been to places where they've never seen white people before, and they had to come and touch our skin. And I've got a daughter with blonde hair that was with me, and they grabbed a hold of her hair. They couldn't believe what, you know, this strange colored hair that she had. So I try and find places that we're not repeating the work that people have already done.
See, when you talk about the dump, folks, it might be hard for us to think about that because we take dirt in and we cover up our garbage.
Oh, yes.
But where you go, it's just there and it's smelly and it's not neat. So now, this is an interesting man, isn't it? I hope you're catching the heart. I'm going back to the fact that your wife's mother sends you this Bible, you start reading, and you're just believing it. Yes. Mm-hmm. And doing it. Mm-hmm. You see, folks, this should be normal. Normal. Because we're citizens of the kingdom of heaven, and that's what we should be doing. Mm-hmm. We're not to look like this world. We are to represent another world. And you can't represent that world and act like people in this world. So God bless you. You know, yes?
If I could just intervene in that, when I first started reading the Bible, I had just graduated. I got my bachelor's degree from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, a fairly prestigious university.
And you're going to get a job and you're reading jobs.
So, yeah. But I'm reading the Bible and I became angry. I kept thinking, why? I'm 22 years old, I've got a bachelor's degree, why have I gone this long in life and nobody ever told me about this book before? Nobody ever told me the truth is right here, all you have to do is read it. And it took me a couple of years to get beyond that, being upset that nobody bothered telling me about this.
Wow.
So that was a stark reality to me. I thought nobody should have to go through life and not know that we have the truth before us.
I hope some of you out there catch this heart. I mean, we can be angry and still, but not sin.
Yes.
So we do need to get angry. You know, this last week at our leadership luncheon, it was one of the pastors was talking about, he has two daughters, and he said it would be unacceptable if one went to heaven and one went to hell. Mm. Unacceptable. Mm-hmm. And we have to adopt that mindset, folks, that the people that live in our cities where you and I live, it is unacceptable that they don't hear. Just totally unacceptable. So now, see that I understand a little more here about you being a hospital chaplain and being a jail chaplain and homeless shelters and thank you for being on the program today. Anything you want to jump in, John, or you just, you're well, like speechless here, you know? That's not you. That's
I really want, as I know Mike does, wants all the glory to go to Christ.
Yes.
And it's humbling to visit those places.
Yes.
And you go with the mindset, Lord, use me, I want to serve. But God does something inside of you when you go to those places. And whether it's in your own city or it's in an international city, you have that experience. And it is very humbling to be used by God, but also the lessons you learn about yourself in the kingdom.
Yes.
And like you said earlier, Charles, it's about being an ambassador.
Yeah.
And the kingdom that we are ambassadors for is completely other than the kingdom of this world. And when we read the Bible, there's such a stark contrast to the teachings that Jesus taught us of how to live from what we see in the world today.
Right.
But Michael is just a shining example of a true Christ follower, where the Word of God has penetrated his heart and life, and now he's being used by God to raise a family, to make a difference in his city, and to make a difference in cities all over the world.
Mike, I was going to say something to people, but I'm going to lead in and let you say it. Folks, here's what I want you to do. I am asking you to do this. As soon as this program is over, I'm asking you to do this. And I'm going to lead in and I'm going to let you finish. I'm going to ask you to get your Bible and get alone and look at this Bible. And I want you to tell them what they should say to God about this. Would you just tell them right now?
Yeah, first I just want to say that whatever I'm telling you is not extraordinary. This is what a normal Christian should be doing, an ordinary Christian. Because as you read this book, you know, this is full of instruction from the Lord. And what happens is when we decide we're going to do it, and that's what you have to look for. It's like there are all kinds of invitations in here. I call it the conditional word of God. You know, if you believe in Jesus, then he'll save you, right? So the condition is you have to believe. And the Bible is full of conditional words. So those are invitations to us. We ought to be reading this and thinking, now, what is God inviting me to do? And then we should say, okay, I'm going to do this. Lord, help me. Show me how. What's the means? God will always make a way. And we do it. We don't just read it and walk away and think, well, that helped me feel better today. I got some warm fuzzies out of it. Although the Lord does that, he gives us comfort and peace. But it's also a book of action.
Yes.
It's a book that says, I'm inviting you in. You want to be part of the kingdom? Come on in. Here it is. Read it. Then go out and do it.
Do it.
And so that's the way I read the scripture. And by the way, when I have something wrong in my life and I read something out of the Bible that's not quite in line with what I'm doing, it's immediately piercing to my heart. It's like, oh no, I need to change that. That's not right. So in that sense, I don't feel like I even have the right to have my own opinion about things unless it comes from what God has given me out of
right.
the scripture. So
right.
that's how important. I write Bible studies just because I love to do it. I sit around and write Bible studies.
Yeah.
It's that important to me.
So when you take your Bible and you look at it, you might need to repent and ask God to forgive you for not believing what he's telling you. Because if you don't, your conscience can get seared. You know, you can always learn but never come to a knowledge of the truth. And if you read and you say, I should do that, well, do it. Because he or she who knows what is right to do and does not do it, well, that's sin. And so you might not be able to go to Panama and India, but you can go in your city. You can go and make a difference in the grocery store. You can go and make a difference in the elementary school, many of which need people to come in and read to kids. You can make a difference somewhere. God will tell you what to do. And so take your Bible and look at it. Just have a conversation with the author. Yeah, good stuff. By the way, these programs are coming to you as a blessing through KFXB. And so if you are moved to support the ministry of KFXB-TV, which is an affiliate of CTN, Christian Television Network, then go to the website. There'll be right on your screen right now, they'll be showing the address where you could mail a donation. There's a website address there where you can go on and you can click on the donate line and donate to this. They do have a Twitter account. KFXB has a large following on Twitter. And so get involved, support this station. They're bringing you good stuff. So if you've just turned in, boy, you need to listen to this because KFXB does archive their programs, and so you can go on the YouTube and find this program and listen from the beginning because he's getting wound up here. So and this man's about to get wound up. So and I never unwind. So we got a trio going here. But this is John Kieffer, if you just turned in, from Appleton, Wisconsin, the state facilitator with the Mission America Coalition, and Mike Breininger from Richland Center, pastor there, Wisconsin. So two Wisconsinites and an Iowan, we're in this together, and KFXB's got this radius that includes Wisconsin and Iowa. So tune back in. God bless you. We're glad you're here. Hope is alive in the United States because God is moving. You talked about how receptive they are in other nations. What it means is we've got to do some more praying, some more fasting for our country and for our neighbors, because there is a sense of hopelessness. But we've got to let God use us to raise up a sense of hope in our nation. So here you are. You've authored some books. You write Bible studies, all kinds of things. But here we are in Richland Center. Mm-hmm. You're pastoring. 2003, we were in the same room. We kind of forgot about each other. But there was a signing of a community marriage agreement in Richland Center for the county. Number of people. And you write sometimes about the church wars and then coming into where we can serve together. And it doesn't just mean from opposing sides, but sometimes even within the evangelical community, you can have wars. And so talk to us about what God has done. Now, I asked you for some points. You gave me six. I don't know we're going to get them done in this last 22 minutes that we have. But the first one you had was the importance of being open to God using us to work across theological, philosophical, and ideological barriers without compromising our convictions. And you learned really good from your wife early on. I'm a Christian, you're not. I'm going back to Connecticut. Well, if I become a Christian, will you stay? She didn't, and you respected her.
Yeah.
So how can you not compromise, respect one another? What's happened in your neck of the woods? Now, when I say your neck of the woods, you actually serve beyond Richland County.
Oh, yes.
You're in southwest Wisconsin.
Yes.
Covers how many counties that you serve in?
About five counties.
About five counties. So, folks, as you're listening to this, pastors, leaders, these gentlemen, if you're in Wisconsin, they can help you get things going in your own communities. They're a resource here. If you're in Iowa, I'm here to help you over here in Iowa. We will work together, too, because we're part of the kingdom.
That's right.
You know, we're one kingdom. We're one people. So, but talk about that point, being able to work together but not compromise.
So the culture wars or the church wars, the 1980s, 90s, early 2000s, I was fully involved in those, in part thinking that it was the right thing to do. In other words, I really thought poorly of liberal churches and liberal pastors, ones that didn't hold to the authority of the scripture. As I told you, the Bible has been so important in my life, and I just couldn't imagine somebody not accepting it as the truth. So the evangelicals and the mainline churches were at war for a long time. We had a ministerial association that was pretty dysfunctional and had shrunk down to just a few people. I attended it so that they wouldn't do anything to disgrace the name of Jesus. I felt like I was there to be kind of the sergeant in arms and not let them do anything to disgrace the name of Jesus, which, you know, it was kind of a militaristic attitude. And then I missed a meeting, and they had elections. They elected me president of the association. So my first thought was,
don't miss any meetings.
No, that wasn't my first, but that probably should have been my first thought. My first thought was, oh, thank you, Lord. I can shut this miserable thing down and be done with it, because it's been nothing but trouble for, you know, all the years I've been in it. It was whatever, 15, 20 years that I had been in it then. And they fought and complained and took it publicly and wrote letters to the editor against each other. And it was just a mess. So I really had a pleasure in thinking about just saying, there's not enough of us anymore, I'm closing this thing down. And then I had a conviction from the Lord.
Yes.
And the conviction was, instead of being a destroyer, to being a builder. I thought, oh no, I have to try and work with these people and these other churches that I disagree with so strongly. So we had a few meetings, and I created something called pastoral courtesies. In other words, they were biblical ways that we should treat each other as churches and pastors, recognizing that, you know, it really wasn't my job to correct everybody else. It was my job to keep myself right with the Lord. The Holy Spirit can take care of His work, and I can take care of mine.
Okay, let me interrupt you. Did you hear that, folks? We are not to be the Holy Spirit to everybody else. We're let the Holy Spirit be the Holy Spirit to us and move through us. Keep going. I just don't miss this stuff. We're getting gold every 30 seconds here, so go ahead.
We went through these pastoral courtesies for like 6 months at every ministerial meeting we had. And the pastors there, liberal or conservative, evangelical, they all said, yeah, we should be treating each other this way. And so they kind of adopted that, and I thought, well, that was good, but it really didn't go far enough. So I approached what would have been my arch enemy in terms of theology. He's a liberal Lutheran pastor who does not respect the Bible as the Word of God as truth. And I said, listen, I want to try and make peace. We are not going to agree. I'd like to make peace with you and see if there's any way that we can work together. And he wanted to do that. So we had a number of discussions over the next 6 months. Some of those were borderline arguments, but there was we had clear lines of what we could agree on and what we couldn't agree on, and where there wasn't going to be compromise. But what happened was the other mainline pastors saw that he was engaged, and the evangelical pastors saw that I was engaged, and the ministerial group started to grow again. We were at about 5 pastors showing up, and now we had 20, 25 pastors coming to this group. And they said, well, let's do something in the community that's meaningful. Now, we had a food pantry, and we had, I think, one homeless shelter at the time, and individual churches had done a lot of things, but as a community of churches, we had not done very much. So we did do some more typical church things. We created a new emergency homeless shelter. We created a program in the public school where we put a pastor in the public school. The school board allowed us to. And he works with families that are troubled families and matches them with families in churches. And so that was really good. We thought we're still not impacting the community the way we want to. So,
well, I think you're doing a lot right there. But see, not enough. Folks, let me just hit a point, so, because this is good. God blesses unity.
Yes.
And as you were talking, I thought of in Romans where it says, insofar as possible with you, be at peace with all men.
Yes.
So I think you're going to get to it, but you came to a point where this respect begins to grow. An appreciation for each other and what can we do together in these social areas. And then the church begins to make a difference.
And not only respect, but trust begins to grow. And what happens is people would come to him and complain about me. And he would say, you know what? I don't want to hear that. He's my friend. I trust him. Do not say anything bad about him. Because we're both pretty well known in the community. And I did the same thing. I said, you know, I don't really want to hear your complaints about this Lutheran pastor. If you've got a problem with him, you need to go to him and you need to deal with him on what the problem is. And out of that, the trust relationships built so that we eventually started calling community members together. And I'm talking about, you know, the judge and the chief of police, the sheriff, the health and human services, the bankers and financial advisors in the community. And we called it the community forum. And we just said, let's talk about what we can do together. By the way, the churches are going to lead the way. We told them that from the beginning. The churches will lead the way. We'll take the lead on this. Because we know there's a lot of work to do. We're not trying to be prideful about it. We'll just lead the way and try to bring people together and see what we can do for our communities. And it's amazing because the leaders of our community were so impressed that the churches would put something like that together that they were on board with us. They said, yeah, we want to do this. And so we had a number of gatherings talking about things that we could do in the community. But we didn't really have a structure yet that would make it happen, would make it come about. So eventually we moved into the next phase, which was to try and kind of organize this community impact and bring people together that were maybe not church people, maybe not Christian people, along with people from the church, and see what we could do together. And it couldn't be anything that violated the convictions of the church. And I'm talking about anybody in the church. But there's amazing how we could do things. So we created a group called Southwest Partners, Southwest Wisconsin, yeah, Southwest Partners. And we've got several hundred people that are involved in that now in our area. And the first thing that we created out of that was, we called the Career Education Cooperative. We have 6 public school districts and 1 private school working together and about 15 major employers in our area. Our university that's in our town, University of Wisconsin-Richland, Southwest Technical College, all those schools and a few hundred community members, we came together and said, we want to do a few things for high school students.
Okay, hold on. A few hundred community partners.
Yes.
Okay. Now, here's what I heard. John, I'm going to ask you what you're hearing. So you think about what you're going to say. But what I'm hearing is Jesus said, I did not come to be served, but to serve. So when you go to community officials and you say, you know, we'd like to do this community form thing, what people hear is more work, mm-hmm. more meetings, etc. And you say, we will serve
yes.
by leading the charge.
Yes.
We'll do the legwork and the response. That's serving.
Yes.
See, and your second point was, when we work together, God works with us.
Mm-hmm.
Your third point was, the Lord wants to use the church to display his wisdom to the world.
And that's exactly what was emerging.
Yeah, and I'm sure there were times that you were saying, oh God, what do we do here? Mm-hmm. What do we do, God? Which leads us into, he who lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who will give to him liberally. And so, you see, the scripture is flowing. You still got that Bible your mother-in-law gave?
Oh, I have that Bible. That one will never go.
So that's what I'm hearing, see? I'm hearing that you're serving without judgmentalism.
Yes.
John, a lot of people know John 3:16, but 3:17 is key. You can't do 16 without 70. He didn't come to judge the world. Sorry, came to serve, to help. John, what are you hearing?
Well, I'm hearing relationship.
Mm-hmm.
He was intentional about going to the other side and saying, I want to build a relationship. And out of that relationship and the openness and the honesty and the trust that was built,
trust,
look what developed.
Yes.
And we say this all the time. We move forward at the speed of trust, at the speed of relationship. And sometimes that's slow because we all carry hurts and wounds and we don't trust. But when we get to know each other's story, and we start to work together, we find out that we have so much in common. And you find those common assets and those common needs in your community, and people will flock to it.
So repeat that. We move forward.
At the speed of trust.
At the speed of trust. And that's what you had. Don't talk that way about my friend.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, and he said the same thing. Don't talk that way about my friend. By the way, no matter what it is, two pastors, two parents, the kids will always try to break them apart. And we got to deal with the kids who are trying to play one side against the other to get their way.
Yes.
So when you two are respecting each other, honoring each other, that sends a sign to other people. And people like to be critical. But back now, here you got 200. I interrupted you. 200 community partners.
All of that was done by just exactly what John was talking about. We actually went and met with people one-on-one before we had some big meeting and said, hey, everybody come to this meeting. A small group of us said, hey, we're going to go out and we're going to meet with people and get to know them in our community. We know a lot of people in our communities by name, by face, by position, but we don't know them by what's the passion of your heart. What's important to you? Who are you? What's your story in life? If you just take 20 or 30 minutes and sit down with somebody and have that kind of conversation, you have crossed a relational bridge that wasn't crossed before. And then there are people who are willing to come in and serve along with you. When you're talking about the service thing, that's exactly what it was. And now we've got these people wanting to serve. So we could do this educational effort that we did where high school students get to go and work for employers, youth apprenticeships. They get to have free college classes. They are involved in community. They have to be involved in community service to be in this program, so they value community. And when they're done, they have these work skill certificates and all kinds of things. We just got an award from the Department of Public Instruction for that. But we didn't do it to get an award. We did it because we wanted to help people and make a difference in people's lives.
Yeah, I remember you said you didn't even know that you were being considered for the award.
Yeah, well.
You're out there too busy doing the work.
Those are two more awards they're giving us now. In January, this just a few weeks from now, we're going to get two other awards. The Richland County Ministerial Association is getting an award for the organization of the year in our county, and the Southwest Partners, our kind of our community impact group, is getting the nonprofit of the year award. Our community got together and voted on that for us. But I want to tell you just a little.
So in your mind, though, it's not you getting the award, it's the community getting the award.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, I hear that in your heart. You hear that, folks? You've said this often about credit. Can you tell us what you say, John?
Well, it's not my quote. It's just the reality that you can't care who gets the credit. Mm-hmm. Because if it's got to be for you or some other pastor or some other organization, that destroys the unity.
We're serving an audience of one.
Right.
That's right.
And he gets all the honor and all the glory and all the credit. That's we right. can't be taking that for ourselves. And that opens the door for us to honestly serve, not for what we get out of it, but simply to help people.
Okay. Can you remember where you were?
Well, I want to interject just a short story here because this is so important. The status of the churches in the community. Last year, in the toward the end of the year, there were two young girls in the high school in Richland Center that were killed in a tragic car accident, 16-year-old girls. Very tragic. The school superintendent picked up the phone. I think I was the first call he made when he heard about it. He said, I need to have 10 pastors at the public high school tomorrow to help our kids process this. Can you have 10 pastors there? And we had 10 pastors there. They gave us a big room. The pastors were there. Kids were coming in. We were praying with them. We were counseling them. We were talking to them about eternity. Down the hall were the school counselors, and they finally came down in the room and said, hey, we don't have anybody coming to us. Could you send some of the kids down to our area? But the point I want to make is, in the past, a school superintendent never would have called the churches and said, can you come over and be a part of this public school tragedy? They would have left it up just to the staff people they had, the counselors. So there's a status that has been gained by the church in our community. The church in general, all the churches, but the church in general is looked at in high esteem now, in ways that it never was before, because we were willing to work together, to serve, to go out there and care about people, and to do things that would be meaningful for the community without self-interest, without that competitive spirit, my church is getting a little too much ahead, and I don't want your church to get too much ahead, or those kind of things. We kind of put that aside and said, let's just go out there and be the church for the community. Mm-hmm. And now the church is in a whole different place than it ever was before.
Did you just say the church should go to the community versus telling people they need to come inside the building? Now, there's a thought, isn't it? Okay, John, I'm going to give you 2 minutes to respond, and then you're going to get the rest of the time to kind of close this down here. So, John?
Well, again, God's at work, and this is a shining example of it. But what you need to know is that this is happening in cities all over the state of Wisconsin, where God is getting his people together who are willing to humble themselves and pray and turn from their own selfishness and return to the mission of teaching people how to love one another. And that's really our goal, is to love our neighbor as much as Jesus has loved us. And when we start to do that, the walls start to come down. When we stop putting ourselves and our own needs first, and we pray and we have a connection with God and we listen to the people around us and the needs that are there, there's opportunities in your neighborhood, in your school, all at work. There's opportunities everywhere if we would just simply open our eyes, open our ears and listen and be ready to serve, not for what's in it for us, but to advance Christ's kingdom. The scripture teaches us, it says, the kingdom of God is not food and drink. It's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So what we get to do is we get to bring righteousness, peace, and joy to the people in our neighborhood, in our workplace, in our community. Mm-hmm. That's what we are as ambassadors for Christ. That's the good news that we get to bring, his righteousness through Christ, his peace and his joy to people. Because people don't have a lot of peace. They're afraid, they're anxious, they're scared. There's so much depression and hopelessness. But the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy. And that's what we are ministers of. And when we do it in humility and unity and love, it really makes a huge difference in people's lives.
Amen. Mike, what would you say to us?
So I just want to say, if Jesus is just inside your church, he's got much more to offer than that. I didn't get to talk about it really, but this actually went to the state level from our little regional effort. And I spend quite a bit of time now working with state leaders, not just government officials, but people that are leaders of organizations and associations on the state level. And we're trying to create this same kind of model throughout the state of Wisconsin, where churches go out, lead their communities in serving, in expressing the reality of Jesus all over, everywhere, in every sphere of life and society. And that's who Jesus should be for us and to us. So if you've been satisfied inside the four walls of the church, get unsatisfied and take Jesus outside beyond that.
So we're going to have you both back next week. We're going to put John in the middle chair, but we're going to hear some more from you too. And so folks, as we close this program out for today, we want to remind you that Serve the City name comes from Jeremiah 29:7. Now we all know verse 11, which says, For, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. But it does start with F-O-R. And if you go back to verse 10, 9, and 8, they start with F-O-R also. I guess if you're using the same version I am. But when you get to verse 7, it says, and seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will have welfare. And that word welfare means an absence of sickness and hurt and depravity, and a presence of God's blessing and his health and vitality. And so it's a different word than we often associate today. And so it's been a pleasure to be with you. Remember what we challenged you to at the start of this program. Take your Bible, get alone, look at it, and talk to God about this. And if you need to repent for not reading it, do that. Repent for not believing it, do that. So tune in again to KFXB Coming Home program. Remember, you are an ambassador of the kingdom of heaven. Live a life worthy of that name. Mm-hmm.